due to COVID and so and issues like that, how safe certain protests can be, and if this contravenes pandemic rules and regulations. Obviously, organizers and people involved have been fined. Hugs over masks protest over the weekend took place in the same area, and again, charges laid there as well. All right, let's bring in Karen Zwiebel, Director of Fundamental Freedoms at the Canadian Civil Liberties Association, and is with us now. Karen, thank you for the time. I hope you're doing well.
Thanks for having me.
So how do you protest safely during a pandemic?
There are certainly ways to protest in ways that do respect many of the public health orders. I think that the challenge is obviously, with respect to the defund the police protest, I think the kinds of safety measures that they're, prepared to engage in are obviously likely pretty different from the hugs over masks protest, right? So I think there is a difference if you're actually protesting the public health measures, then you may be engaged in acts of civil disobedience to take on that protest. But if that's not what your protest is about, then I think that there certainly are ways to keep people distanced. Obviously, masking might be important, although again, in outdoor context, we haven't really been told that that's something we're required to do unless you're going to be confined with a group of people for an extended period of time. So, I think there are ways to do this safely, and I think we saw that earlier, during the summer when we had a lot of the anti-Black racism protests, which happened for the most part with really minimal sort of engagement by the police, except maybe in the province of Quebec, but generally in Ontario, those protests were. The rights of those protesters were respected by police.
You bring up an interesting point, though, during a pandemic, and always, obviously we talk about people's rights and their freedoms to protest as long as they're within the confines of the law and so on and so forth, but then you forget about, gee whiz, if we are in the midst of a pandemic, then those people could be endangering other people's lives, so there's, all of a sudden there's two sides of this coin.
There's always, I think with protests, even outside of pandemic context, there are always competing claims and issues. People raise concerns that protests, think of blockades, that they inconvenience people, they cost people money, they disrupt businesses, they disrupt lives. But in many ways, that's really what protest is about. That's why it's protected, because it is meant to be disruptive in many cases. That's how you get attention for your issue. That's how you sometimes get decision makers to engage with you. So, I think that I'm not sure that with respect to the defund the police protest, I haven't really heard that the concern is about public health. It seems that, I know there are bylaws that say you can't erect tents in these spaces, and those are the bylaws that are being sort of enforced here, but I'm not sure that that's actually related to the pandemic, and I'm not sure that it's necessary in these circumstances, whether it is really causing a public health concern or a public order concern. From what I've heard, these protests have been peaceful, and there is some symbolic importance to the tents when you're talking about a protest that is talking about homelessness and the need for people to have adequate shelter.
I think that's where the issue is erecting the tents, which, and I should mention that we have obviously reached out to the city of Hamilton. They're still dealing with the dismantling of the tents at this point, so hopefully have someone to speak on this later on today or tomorrow. I remember when they were redesigning the new Hamilton City Hall, and one of the whole reasons behind, especially with the forecourt, was to design a much more people-friendly place where, you could have certain things going on and so on and so forth, but they probably obviously didn't anticipate something to this extent. How do you balance this, a place for people to do and congregate like this, and yet on the other hand obviously not present some sort of threat or situation for the rest of the public?
Yes, I mean, it's a really good question, and it's difficult. I think when courts are looking at these issues and you know, in instances where these types of things have been challenged, and the most obvious example that comes to mind is when there was sort of the Occupy Wall Street movement, and there were protests all across the cities, all across Canada and the United States, where people were camped out in often, you know, public spaces. And those were generally allowed to continue for an extended period of time. Eventually, they were dismantled, and for the most part, courts tended to agree with, side with cities and say this isn't something that can go on indefinitely. In some ways, actually, the pandemic context arguably actually strengthens the case for allowing tents, because these are not public spaces where the normal uses are competing quite as much, right? We're not having, music festivals. People aren't supposed to be out and about and congregating. And so in some sense, there is, potentially an argument that that there should be a bit more allowance for this kind of protest.
So what happens, again, obviously the issue becomes one of safety once people start erecting tents and living there. Again, how do you balance that? Because that's clearly where, they step in to take things down. Protest, fine. Tents, not so much, obviously.
Yeah.
So, go ahead. But you said, that certainly does draw attention, that gives, a reason for people to look at the cause. So your thoughts on all of that and balancing that with, defunding this group, wants to defund the police by 50% and use that towards public housing and such. At what point do you say, okay, the point's made and move on?
With regards to tents,
with regards
to
settlements.
I mean, that's really for the activists that are involved in that movement to decide. I think, they know what their goals are, and they're the ones that are in a position to decide whether those goals have been met or whether they've sort of gotten the attention and the ears that they need on the issue. I think that it is always, I appreciate that you said you're hoping to speak to someone from the city, because I think it really is always incumbent on the government, the police, whoever it is that is involved in restricting this right to protest, to justify it. And it can't, in my view, just be that, well, there's a bylaw that says you can't do this. I think you do have to consider the individual circumstances and say, is there really a need for these tents to come down right now? Are they actually posing a threat? Is there genuinely a public safety risk? Or is this just a matter of, the law is the law and this is what needs to happen? Because I think there can be, allowances made, just like there were allowances made for, larger gatherings than were technically permitted under the public health guidelines during the anti-Black racism protests. So those protests, there was a recognition that this was an issue that a lot of people cared about, that they wanted to take to the streets and have their voices heard. And